Hey guys, so today in preparation for a panel, I'm, panel slash workshop slash something I'm leading for Nokus Fest in New Orleans, we're gonna talk about inking goodies and inking utensils today. And I've got the dual camera up. Sorry, you guys can kind of see it in the shot. So we can get a close-up view of some of the tools and materials we're gonna be looking at today. So we're gonna start off with inking utensils. And many of you are probably familiar with things like these. You're probably very familiar with tech pins, and we will talk about those a little bit today, but we're gonna talk about all sorts of other goodies today as well. And for those of you who are interested in inking and you haven't yet, please check out my Inktober 2016 videos, many of which are underneath the Art Snacks Inktober 2016, I do believe. I will link that in the card though, so you guys can find that very easily. So let's go ahead and dive right on in. We're gonna talk first about some more traditional inking implements, such as brushes. I picked those up today because I went and hit up Jerry's Artarama, one of my favorite art supply stores. And we're also going to talk about, I know I had them. Oh, duh, right there. Nibs and nib holders. And we're also going to talk about, probably a bit briefly, reed pens. And we're also going to talk about fountain pens. And I mean, really, we're gonna talk about everything. So we're gonna get started with brushes. And brushes and nibs are probably some of the first inking utensils used, certainly for illuminating manuscripts, which would be, some might even argue, I would argue it, some of the first examples of sequential art. Well, I guess the cave paintings are more of the first example of sequential art, silly me. And then I would consider like altarpieces that were done for churches to be sequential art because they are depicting multiple scenes in a sequence. But illuminated manuscripts might be some of the first examples that we could even call comics. Although I'm sure many of you fine artists over there are really bristling. Get over it. So these are two brand new Kolinksy Sable brushes. It's a 0 and a 1. I am very heavy-handed, so you wanna, if you're heavy-handed like me, you're gonna wanna work with smaller brushes. And brushes go up in size sequentially. So 0 would be small, 00 is even smaller, 000 is even smaller than that, and 1 would be larger, 2 larger than that, etc. For most of us, if we're inking a comic page, 4 is as big as you're really gonna need to get unless you're doing fills. So if you are inking with a brush, you may want to use one of these. These are called Dinky Dips, and they are teeny tiny little containers that you can put your ink in, and they're held quite securely by this little block of wood, and you can get those through Paper and Ink Arts. And here are some inks that are suitable for use with brushes. We have a Sumi ink. We have Deleter black ink. This is number 4. So this is alcohol marker and waterproof. Drawing Soul K, which is alcohol marker but not waterproof. Winsor Newton water-based ink. It's a liquid Indian ink. It does not have a shellac in it. This is not waterproof. This is very water soluble. And acrylic inks. And if you're working with shellac inks like Indian inks or acrylic inks, you really want to clean that out of your brush as soon as you're done. But in general, I usually ink with a Sumi ink because it's pretty convenient and I have it handy. And that's actually what's in my little Dinky Dip here. So when you are starting with brand new brushes, you want to clean them out, and because they have something, a little stiffening agent, usually like a gelatin in the bristles, and you want to use Old Master soap or a very, very mild baby shampoo. So these are brand new brushes. I have never, ever used them. So I'm going to go clean them out, and I'm also going to grab a cup of water. Now, what I'm using to demonstrate is a Denik notebook with very smooth, almost a plate finish paper. It is not that I necessarily recommend this. It is that it is what I have, and it is suitable for the project. All right, so we have assembled a glass of water, which you guys can't see, but there it is. It's in an old tea container, some scrap paper, and it's actually just watercolor paper that I had lying about. We've got our paper and my Dinky Dip. So I'll go ahead and open that. And Dinky Dips are great because they only hold about as much ink as you need. So if you have marauding cats, they're not gonna knock it all over the place. So you don't wanna dip too far past the metaferral. You never wanna dip beyond it. And you wanna use your paper to get off the excess ink. And while we're here, I'll demonstrate. Go ahead and move this over. I'll demonstrate dry brush technique for you guys. So you start off loads of ink, and you see as we're running out how it gives that sort of dry, scratchy look. This is called dry brush, and it can be a great technique for adding texture and shade to like concrete or bricks or smoke. It will wreck your brush though, so you don't want to use it with your best brush. Making a mess today. Whereas, this is what it looks like on a smoother finished paper. You're not going to get the dry brush, but you are going to get very crisp lines that don't break up. I say that, and then it dry brushes. And brushes do take a lot of practice. They take a lot of getting used to. They take a lot of control. And most inkers do prefer Kolinksy Sable brushes. Inking with a synthetic brush probably can be done, but I don't know of any professionals that use a synthetic brush to ink their pages. They might use a synthetic brush like I do with their correctional fluid, but you're just going to get a lot of it's just not going to handle as nicely as a Kolinksy Sable brush. And I get mine, like I said, from Jerry's Artarama. They're some of the most affordable Kolinksy Sables. You also have a shorter brush than you would on other brands, but I like that because I'm somewhat heavy-handed, which is also why I go with the smaller tip. So we'll go ahead and move on to nibs. And I do have video and blog posts going over nibs in great detail. This is just sort of an inking overview. So you could think of nibs as being categorized in several different very basic ways. You could think of them as nibs for calligraphy, handwriting, or drawing. You could think of them as Eastern nibs versus Western nibs. You could think of them versus fixed width versus flexible width. All of those are valid categories for nib inking. Right here in this box, I have fixed width nibs that are typically used for lettering and calligraphy. We have an A nib right here, and it has sort of a square blunted tip. We have a B nib, let me get a big one so I can show you, which has a circular tip. Sorry, trying to get my camera to focus. We have C nibs. I know I have a D nib in here somewhere. C nibs, which are more for calligraphy, and they have sort of a rectangular tip. And we also have some Mitchell nibs here. And then a D nib, which has an oval tip. Now, all of these are going to give you one consistent line weight. The italic nibs will give you two because you have the broad downstroke and then a narrow side stroke, and I can show you guys that in a minute. I'll grab a couple of these. And then also in here you have Crowquills, or I have Crowquills, which are a flexible with nib, and they've been around for quite a long time, and these are very, very much accessible. They're sold in a wide variety of art supply and craft style stores, like you could even find them at Michael's. Speedball is a very common purveyor of those. So, just grab an inexpensive nib holder for this. And these work well on smoother papers. And this Mitchell nib has a ink reservoir, so it should not be skipping like this, but it is. But you see, it uses a lot of ink as well to put down that very broad line. Let's see. No. Just having no luck with that today. We'll just go ahead and move on then to the B nib. And Bs are the opposite, fixed width nibs are the opposite of brushes in that they increase in size reverse sequentially. So 6 would be very small, 1 and 0 would be very large. And these are typically used for lettering, though I am having trouble with it today. Now, moving into more flexible nibs, you have a wide variety. This might have the most variety. You have this little Crowquill, inexpensive, commonly available, not wanting to work today. Can do very, very fine lines, but is flexible enough to put down some very wide dark lines. Of course, if you run out of ink, it'll do this thing called railroading, where, and it seems like my camera is not capturing that, so let me try to adjust that. Railroading, where it will split like so and may put down two lines like that. Of course, by demonstrating like that, I ruined the tip, so I use it backwards to sort of push the tines back into place. So next we're going to move on over to some of my favorite nibs, G nibs. These are Japanese manga nibs. You may also have heard of a school G or a school nib. I don't think I have any school nibs with me, but these are also very capable, very fine, or fairly fine. They're a little thicker than the Crowquill, but they're also capable of, nope, come on you. Much thicker lines, and it doesn't have the reservoir that this Speedball nib has on the front or this Mitchell nib has on the back. Although I do believe Paper and Ink Art sells something called ink cages, which you can insert into these and it'll help hold some of that ink. And typically nibs can really only write in one direction, or they only really work well in one direction. Next, oh, and this is a Tachikawa holder. This is one of my favorites because it has a ring for small nibs like Crowquill and larger nibs as well. We have a variety of Hunt nibs, which are classified as being in the Crowquill family. Probably need to refill my Dinky Dip. That's probably a big part of why I'm running so low. So Crowquills tend to be very, very flexible. Use one of these smaller ones, and this goes in. No, I guess it goes in the second ring. I thought I was going to go in the first. But these sort of nibs typically have two tines, and if I can get this nib on, I will draw that for you. So that is the tip of the nib. That is the breather hole. And that is the separation of the two tines. So really, they're separated, but you don't want them to look like this. Those are splayed nibs. You want them to look like they're touching. And you can find nib sets, especially Speedball and Hunt nib sets, pretty much at any art supply store and at Michael's. So next we're going to move on over to spoon nibs. And spoon nibs are, they're also called globe nibs. So this would be a globe nib, and this is a Hunt globe. And this is a Kuretake Sa-Ji, no, it's, I lied to you, it's a Nigo Sa-Ji nib. And they look very similar, although not exactly the same. And they're going to handle very similarly. I'm going to go ahead and put in Nico. I really need to refill my Dinky Dip. And spoon nibs are capable of very fine, light line work, sort of like what you would see in shoujo manga. And with these, you build up tones, not by applying a great amount of pressure, but by building it up through like cross hatching. So that is a very basic overview of metal nibs. And since we're still here, I will quickly demonstrate that there are some very basic types of holders as well. You have the cork holder, you have the plain plastic inexpensive Speedball type holder that tends to only hold one type, and then you have the nicer holders that have a bit more of a grip. And I really prefer the Japanese holders like this Tachikawa or this Kuretake. We're going to diverge very briefly into fountain pens. These are not commonly used inking utensils, but I've gotten into them recently, and they're very similar to nibs, dip pen nibs versus fountain pen nibs. Let me grab my example nib. So this is what a fountain pen nib looks like. Sorry, trying to use that second camera. And this is, these are all inky, inky and wet. Oh, wow. These are, that's one of the Crowquills. And this is the spoon. Let me tilt the camera so I can get that from another angle. As you can see, they look similar, but they're very different. And let me actually grab one of my nib holders and we'll see if we can't get it to take it. Now, this is a size 6 nib. G nibs are a size 6 nib. Oh, look at that. You can put, if it's the right size, you can put a fountain pen nib in your dip pen. So it is a thing you could do if you so desired. Let's see if we can get it to write like this. Just completely going off the deep end. Oh, you can. Wow. Learn something new every day. And most fountain pen nibs just aren't as flexible as your dip pen nibs. But hey, it works. And I have a video, an overview video, that I recorded with my friend Heidi Black, where she explains fountain pens to me, like fountain pens for drawing, fountain pens for sketching, that sort of thing. And you can check out this card here to find that video if you find this interesting. That is a much more in-depth topic. And I'm not going to get into that today because we already covered that. So you guys can check that out over there. And I clean my hands off a little bit with an alcohol wipe. Now here are three fountain pens. And they're very different. We have a Sailor Fude de Mannen, and this is called a Fude style nib. And you can see it has eight. Let me see if I can get it over here instead. Like this. The nib kind of kips off into the into the sky. And they come in two different angles, typically a 45 and a 55. And this is typically used to mimic sort of Japanese kanji. So it handles a little bit more like you would. The end effect looks more like a brush. It does not handle like a brush. It does not have much give, but it's fun to sketch with. This is a Noodler's Flex. And this is more of a sketching fountain pen, but it's still not really a sketching pen, although I really like sketching with it. And you can get fine lines and you can get nice thick lines as well. And it's spidering on this paper, and we'll talk about that in a minute. And then finally, we have a modified, I modified it, Jinhao, which is where this nib came from. And it's been modified to take a G nib. Let's see if I can get it to write today. It's a little finicky sometimes. And I made this Franken pin because because Heidi had one and I had fun playing with hers. And I'm still kind of modifying it because I want to increase the ink flow, because as you can see, it does railroad really badly. But those are fountain pens. And fountain pens typically use a water-based ink. What I have in mine is actually platinum carbon ink. And platinum carbon is a pigment-based ink, so when it fully dries, it will be waterproof. But most fountain pens use, in fact, all fountain pens use special fountain pen inks. You should not be putting your acrylic inks, your Bombay India inks, your etc. inks in fountain pens, because that'll ruin them. So we're going to go way, 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 way back. We're going to go into prehistory back, and we're going to talk really briefly about reed pens. And I should zoom out for that. Reed pens. And sorry to kip the camera. We have a giant. We have a large, and then, no, wait, this is the large. Sorry. They make a lovely sound though. Giant, large, medium, small. Most of them are double-sided. And I'm gonna go ahead and open my Sumi ink and just dip directly into that rather than messing with the Dinky Dip. In fact, I think I'm at the point where I can cap my Dinky Dip. This giant here. And these pretty much put down two line weights. That one and that one. but they're inexpensive and they're fun to sketch with and they're fun to draw with. They certainly have a distinctive feel. But you're pretty much not going to get much line weight variation, even with a small one. And, come on, these can be recut to suit your drawing needs. Like this one is getting very scratchy and not wanting to draw. As you guys can see, they are cut a lot like a pin nib would be cut, where you have the two tines and a breather hole. And also the ink will usually sit up in here and is drawn down to the nib by the capillary action of the striations in your bamboo. And you can make your own. There are artists who certainly do that, just as you can cut your own if you have some bamboo growing in your backyard. I have some, maybe I ought to give it a shot. I have some giant, so I can make like some massive, huge, you guys can't see what I'm doing. Some really big ones out of the bamboo in my backyard. So that's a very basic, quick overview of more traditional inking materials, brushes, dip pens, fountain pens, and reed pens. I will be right back with some more modern materials that you guys might be more familiar with. I return with technical pens and brushes, and these all have a reservoir inside. Sometimes they have a capsule, sometimes they have a felt soaked wick inside, but these are all self-contained inking tools. So we're gonna go ahead and I'm actually gonna grab a couple more while I'm thinking about it, while we're discussing it. You guys can't see this, but I actually have a pretty large hoard of inking utensils at my desk packed away. So we're gonna go ahead and take a look. So next in our history of pens, you have rapidographs and isographs. And these are actually really out of use. They're out of repair. I need to clean them. The ink inside is all dry. They take a very special type of ink that it is rapidograph ink. Oh wow, look how shameful this one is. Just put that there where you guys can get a nice close look. But I pretty much have only used these when I was taking a hand lettering class at SCAD. But I do know artists who do enjoy these pens. So I'm not knocking it. It's just, wow. Less likely that you guys are going to be using these sort of pens. And these are somewhat, wow, I need to give up on this one. These are somewhat similar to ballpoint pens in that they have a metal tube and they often have a little bitty ball or a bearing inside. And as you draw, you need to hold it perpendicular in order for it to make a mark. And they are a fixed line width pen. So you're not gonna get any line variation from these. This one might, nope. Literally none of these work. They are all dead. I need to clean them out and restore them because I am a bad pen owner. But these are rapidograph pens. So if you hear people talking about using them, if you hear people giving you shade because they use them and real artists use them and you don't use them, don't feel bad. There are artists who do enjoy them. They're not as popular as they used to be. There are other tools that might better serve your purposes. So we're going to move on to their successor, technical pens. And there are two brands that most people are very familiar with in the US. We have Sakura Micron. And these come in a bunch of sizes. I'm trying to lay some out for you guys. And these were kindly sent to me a little while back by Sakura of America. and they did not request anything in return, which is extremely generous of them. So I am more than happy to feature and to show them off on the channel whenever relevant and whenever necessary. These are a very excellent introduction to technical pens. They are archival, they are waterproof, they are alcohol marker proof. They come in a variety of sizes, from graphic, which is a 1 millimeter, to 8 millimeter, which has that metal sleeve that you guys might recognize from the rapidographs, to very, very fine 0.05 millimeters. And these will dry out if you leave them uncapped, so I'm only uncapping them for demonstration purposes. But these are quite popular among comic artists. The only real problem is you're only ever going to get one line weight from them. And they're not refillable, so they do run out of ink. So if you want to build up a thick line and you've only got one on hand, or you want to build up some line weight variation, you have to do that by hand. Then, if you're looking for something that's going to last a little bit longer, you have the refillable Copic multiliners. And I purchased these right when I started SCAD, and they are very beaten up. Let's see if my 0.5 is still working. These have a aluminum body, and they have replaceable nibs, which you can replace by pulling out this metal ring right here. And they also have a replaceable ink cartridge inside. So basically it's kind of an expensive system. The reason you might go for this is it is putting a little less waste into the environment when you wreck your nib or when you run out of ink. Let me see if I have a refill. I have refill nibs for sure. So that is what the refill nib looks like. And let me see if I have a refill of the ink itself. I might. I'm sure I do. I just can't find it. But it is in a cartridge format. Oh, wow. And then you also have calligraphy pens. And calligraphy pens can be super handy because they come in this weird chisel sort of shape. So this is a 5 millimeter width. Very similar to a tape nib. And then you can also go this way and get a much thinner. And these are pretty good for borders on your comic panels. Here's another one. You just need to make sure that if you're going to do ink wash or if you're going to color it with markers, that it is rated safe for that, because I am pretty sure this is a water-based ink, so this will work with your alcohol markers, but it will not be good for ink washes. And this one is, it doesn't even say. So you should know what your materials are made out of. That way you know what you can use them with. Next, we have some brushes. I'll actually put this one away for a moment. Sakura of America makes a brush pen, as does Copic of America, or Copic, period. And this is actually one of their SP ones, and they're not selling these anymore because you can't replace the brush and the brush gets wrecked. They did, however, recently introduce the Gaz and Fude, and we'll talk about that in a little while, probably. So, you also have the Sakura of America Pigma brushes, which use the same alcohol marker proof / waterproof ink, but they come in three sizes. So you have a nice large brush, and this brush is actually foam rubber, almost the same stuff they make the Copic Super Nibs out of. Very flexible, lot to give. I really like this one. The medium one feels like compressed fiber, so it's not as nice. It's a little scratchier. It's more prone to getting chewed up. And then you have the fine brush, which is very fine indeed. But you can still get some nice line variation with that. In fact, the fine brush is about the same size as some of my favorite brushes for inking Fude pens. this would be one of my favorites. It is the Kuretake Fude Gokochi. As you can see, it's pretty much the same size as the FB. It is not waterproof, but it is, I am told, Copic proof. But I usually just grab a Sailor Mitsuo Ida brush pin, which is Copic proof and waterproof. And this one is not refillable, but this Kuretake brush pin, Fude pen, features cartridges. In fact, there's room for one more, surprise! And these sort of refillable, rechargeable cartridge pins are pretty common for what you're going to see from Japanese pens. So we're gonna move on now to brush pins that feature individual bristles. We have a Sailor Ryofuda, which seems kind of dry because I haven't used it in a while. And let me see if I can get it to show the individual bristles. Typically used for calligraphy. And then you have a Pentel, not the pocket brush. My pocket brush is somewhere. Also has individual bristles, great for dry brush techniques on the go. And now we have the Pentel pocket brushes, and these are special ones. Usually Pentel pocket brushes require cartridges, but I converted these to be eyedropper filled Pentel pocket brushes instead to take the sort of ink I want them to take. So this has the carbon black in it. And basically with an eyedropper conversion, and I do have a tutorial on this so you guys can watch that as well, you fill the entire plastic body with ink, with an eyedropper. And then this happens to have some radiant watercolor in it. So that is a basic overview of the tools we use for inking. If you're curious as to how any of these can be used for comics, well, gee, I'm sorry. I do need to do a video where I ink a page for you guys on camera. So hopefully that will be coming up soon. We will very briefly talk about papers in this demonstration, although I'm afraid it's harder for me to demonstrate papers for you guys than it is for me to demonstrate materials. You basically have quite a few options when it comes to inking, but we're going to talk about sort of plate surfaces like this Denik and sort of rougher textured surfaces like this fluid watercolor paper. Now, if you're inking on something like plate, it's going to be harder to get dry brush effects. Your ink's going to take a little bit longer to dry, but you're going to be able to get very, very crisp lines. Plate also doesn't necessarily take watercolor very well, but it scans a little nicer, original, like without modification, it scans a little nicer than tooth paper, like watercolor paper or vellum, and you can use markers over it if your ink is marker compatible. With these sort of toothed papers, they take watercolor a little bit better. I recommend if you're going to use it for that, you get a 140-pound or heavier paper. You can, you may be able to find them a little bit more easily, and you're going to get a dry brush effect very easily with these sort of papers. They also can take a lot of abuse. So in the sort of plate category, you're going to have bristles like Strathmore plate bristle, and I recommend the 500 series for best results. For a more toothy surface, you can go with semi-smooth and you can go with vellum. Vellum has less tooth than cold press watercolor paper, but it still has a lot of texture. Now, bristles can be a little bit cost prohibitive, so if you're just starting out, you can practice on smooth cardstocks. You can go buy a ream of smooth cardstock and practice on that. It's going to have much the same effect. Or you can buy inexpensive watercolor papers like Biggie Canson XL watercolor paper in 140-pound. Those are sold pretty much everywhere. And they are heavier watercolor paper. They are a student-grade, inexpensive watercolor paper, so your watercolors are not going to handle quite as nicely on that paper. But for inking practice, especially with dry brush effects, that might be the way to go. So I wanted to thank you guys so much for watching this quick little overview of inking materials and supplies. I hope you guys found it helpful. I hope you found it useful. If it inspired any questions, please let me know in the comments below. And be sure to check out my inking Advanced Inking Techniques playlist and my Supply Overviews playlist for more like this. I also recommend you check out my Art Snacks Inktober playlist, which is also linked somewhere in this video, because I cover a lot of these materials in greater detail and in greater depth, so it may answer some of the questions that you might have. You can also check out my blog at natasoup.blogspot.com. I've written about inking extensively, and I took copious notes while I was taking advanced inking techniques at SCAD. So that information is up on the blog in a handy dandy written format in case you retain information better that way. Like I said, thank you guys so much for hanging out with me. It's always a pleasure to hang out with you art nerds here in my studio. If you enjoyed this video, please remember to hit like. Please consider subscribing for more great content like this. We update twice a week on Tuesdays and Saturdays. If you'd like to help support what we do, there are a number of ways you can do that. You can share this video with your friends and family on your favorite social networks using those handy social sharing buttons below the video. You can also check out our Patreon at patreon.com/natosoup. Patreons get early access to videos like this. They get to make requests as to what content I will be producing in the future. They get voting rights on upcoming content that is in the works. And they get the warm fuzzies knowing that they're helping to support art education. So thank you guys so much for hanging out with me. I hope to see you guys again really soon. I'm Becca Hilburn from NatoSoup Studio. Bye. Hey guys, so this is a resumption of my overview video for inking materials. And I went ahead and I swatched a bunch of different inks, and we're about to test them for water solubility and Copic marker solubility. So I have got one brush pin full of water, and I have got one Copic chow. Actually, I want something that is a little fresher and more juicy than this. So give me a momento to grab one Blix. No, that's in a dark color. That's not what I wanted. You know what? Here is a Prismacolor colorless blender. Honestly, they're all pretty much the same. So we're testing for water fastness and Copic safeness, and we're gonna start with Winsor & Newton India ink, which on the bottle is non-waterproof. And as you can see, it reactivates pretty readily while still leaving the original ink mark in place. And I need to go dig up a paper towel. It's across the room. Of course it's across the room. In high school, I had this chemistry teacher who I pretty much adored, Miss Butler. And she was a big advocate of the scientific method. She's also a very big advocate of cleaning your materials so it doesn't contaminate your next experiment. So I guess, Miss Butler, this one goes out to you. So next we're gonna test the De La Rowney India ink, which is water resistant. And you guys can see with some scrubbing, it does start to lift the ink. It's not too, too bad. All right, De La Rowney FW acrylic ink. It does seem like some color is transferring, especially as I scrub harder, which is surprising because I thought acrylics were supposed to be waterproof. So that is a thing. All right, next we got Sumi Ink, which very quickly reconstitutes. This would actually probably be ideal for ink washes. Now we've got the Pintail Pocket Brush. And finally, Deleter Black Ink, which is actually pretty. I'm sure if I really, really scrub, yeah, there we go. But it's starting to abrade the paper too. So of the inks tested, the best for waterproof is Deleter Black 40. Next is De La Rowney India ink, or, you know, I wish I had some Bombay India ink because that's actually my preference, but I am fresh out. And then next would be the De La Rowney acrylic ink tied with the Pentel pocket brush. Pentel pocket brush did surprisingly well. Let us move on over, baby, to the Copic. Oh wait, I wanted to use a Blick. Where did I put it? No, not the Blick, this thing. Yes. No. Yes. All right. India ink, the water, non-waterproof kind is Copic proof. The water resistant kind is not. That's that shellac. This is dissolving the shellac, so it's moving the pigment, whereas this was water-based entirely, and things that are water-based tend to not be picked up by alcohol-based things and vice versa. Next, the acrylic ink. Oh yeah, because this is dissolving the acrylic a bit. Next, the Sumi ink. Oh, excellent, excellent for Copics. I mean, when I smeared my thing back in there, I put some old dirt, so let's re-demonstrate. Oh yeah, that's the stuff. Pentel pocket brush is also Copic proof. And finally, deleter, which seems to be Copic proof. So our inks that are Copic proof: Winsor & Newton India Ink, the non-waterproof version, Kuretake Sumi Ink 60, Pentel Pocket Brush Ink, the ink that comes in the cartridges, and Deleter Black number 4. Not 40, I think I said 40 before. So I hope you guys found this helpful. There are indeed a world of inks out there, and I do actually have many more. And there's a lot of variety between different brands, even within brands, one brand. Even there's variety even within a single brand, like PH Martin's makes a bunch of different inks, and they're all going to have different properties. This was just a very basic overview of some very commonly available inks, as well as some very commonly available ink types. So hopefully this will set you guys in the right direction for selecting inks for your watercolor and your Copic or other alcohol marker needs. I'm Becky Hilburn. Thank you guys so much for watching this overview. Thank you guys so much for hanging out with me today. I hope you learned something. I hope you left inspired. If you have any questions, make sure you leave a comment down below and I'll get to it. If you need to get a hold of me, you can tweet me at NattoSoup or you can send me an email. And you can find that email information on my blog. For loads more inking goodness, you can check out the Art Snacks Inktober playlist, which I will link right there. Or you can check out my blog at nattosoup.blogspot.com. There's an entire subsection for inking to help you guys get started or help you sort of nick the knack. I review loads and loads of inking supplies, including brush pens and inks. So if that sounds like a thing that you would be interested in, you can click right here to, really not right there, it's a card. You can click the card to head on over to my blog and check that out. If you haven't yet, I highly recommend you subscribe to my channel for more arty goodness, updated twice a week, often more than that. And if you'd like to support this channel, there are a number of ways you can do that. You can share this video with your friends and family on your social networks. Facebook, Twitter, Tumblr, all of those are great places to share content like this. This is family-friendly content. So if you have a young one in your life who dreams of being an artist, you might be doing them a huge favor by introducing them to this channel. My goal is to educate and entertain, so if I did that, make sure you leave a like. It's also nice when you guys let me know, but by no means mandatory. And if you would like to help support more content on this channel, there are a number of ways you can do that. You can write in to some of the companies mentioned in these overviews and reviews and let them know how much you appreciate my opinion and my reviews. This means a lot to me, and it actually tells them a lot about how dedicated you guys are about my content. So if you would like to see me review a certain company's what have you, one of the ways to do that is to write to them and let them know that you want to see me review that. Who knows? Maybe they'll send me one. Another way you can help support this channel is by making sure you watch those ads. It is a small favor to ask. Go make yourself a sandwich, go hit the bathroom, or hey, just relax. Though we as YouTube content creators don't get paid unless those ads are watched. You don't need to click them. You don't need to care. You just need to sit through it. And finally, if you join me on my Patreon, if you become an official art nerd at patreon.com/nattosoup, you're going to gain all sorts of goodies, including mini comic downloads, early access to chapters of 7-inch Kara Volume 2, which is in progress. That is my ongoing watercolor family-friendly comic about a little girl named Kara and her larger-than-life adventures. You will also gain early access to videos and many backer exclusives. And that is patreon.com/natosoup. So thank you guys so much for watching. As always, it is a joy to have you in my studio. I hope you guys have a great day, and I hope you get inky. I'm Becca Hilburn. I'll see you guys later. Bye.